Explore the worlds of Doctor Who with BBC Audio's range of titles.
Don't turn around, don't look away, don't blink.
Available now on CD and digital download.
Doctor Who, Planet of Giants by Terrance Dix. Read by Carole Ann Ford. Chapter 1, Dangerous Landfall. It was a beautiful summer's day. From a clear blue sky, the sun shone down on the perfect country cottage in the perfect English country garden. The cottage had a thatched roof, green lawns, blossoming flower beds, a thriving vegetable patch, and a stone-flagged patio. It was a place to dream of. The ideal weekend retreat, a long-awaited haven for retirement. It was also the home of an unseen menace that threatened all life on Earth. Soon it was to be the scene of the Doctor's most grotesque and terrifying adventure. "We're approaching a planet now," announced the Doctor. Inside the extraordinary space-time vessel called the TARDIS, a tense little group gathered around the many-sided central control console. At first sight, they formed a strange, ill-assorted company. Busy at the controls was the Doctor himself, a white-haired old man with a lined and wrinkled face, an aristocratic beak of a nose, and eyes that blazed with a fierce intelligence. He wore an antiquated-looking frock coat, a cravat, and a high-winged collar, check trousers, and old-fashioned boots, the whole ensemble topped with a fur-collared cloak. Beside him stood a slim, dark-haired young woman, in slacks and a crisp white blouse, her face set in her habitual expression of mild disapproval. Her name was Barbara Wright, and no child would have been very surprised to learn that she was, or rather had been, a school teacher. Next to her was a cheerful-looking young man in sports jacket and flannels, complete with collar and tie, and a handkerchief in the top pocket. He too was a teacher, and his name was Ian Chesterton. The fourth member of the group was the youngest, a girl of about 16 wearing denim dungarees. She had short dark hair and big dark eyes. Her name was Susan Foreman, and she called the Doctor Grandfather. It was Susan who was responsible for the presence of Ian and Barbara in the TARDIS. During her brief spell as a pupil at Coal Hill School, in the London of the 1960s, the extraordinary range of Susan's knowledge, and the even stranger gaps in it, had aroused their curiosity to such an extent that they'd followed her home. To their astonishment, they discovered that home was a police box in a junkyard, and that the grandfather with whom Susan claimed to live was the amazing old man known only as the Doctor. With the best of intentions, Ian and Barbara had forced their way into the TARDIS and had promptly been carried off through space and time to an extraordinary series of adventures. Ricocheting between Earth and a variety of alien planets, they had encountered cavemen, Daleks, the warriors of Kublai Khan, the Voids of Marinus, a murderous Aztec priest, and the extraordinary dome-headed sensorites. In many ways, their most recent adventure had been the most unsettling of all. Once again, the Doctor had managed to get them back to Earth, and once again he'd landed them in quite the wrong time period and in deadly danger. Instead of the London of the swinging 60s, they'd found themselves confronted with the Paris of the French Revolution, where they'd come perilously near to losing their heads. They had become embroiled with the plots of an English secret agent called James Stirling, and had witnessed the bloody downfall of the tyrant Robespierre at the hands of the revolution he'd done so much to bring about. Somehow, the fact that this terrifying adventure was taking place on Earth made things seem worse rather than better. It bore out one of the Doctor's favourite sayings, that of all the savage species in the galaxy, few were more dangerous and bloodthirsty than man. Now they were about to try again. It was Ian who reacted to the doctor's announcement that they were approaching a planet. With an expression of cheerful skepticism, he asked, "Which one?" His tone indicated that he didn't expect the doctor to have the answer. The doctor shot Ian an offended glance. Despite frequent demonstrations of his inability to steer the TARDIS with any real accuracy, he bitterly resented any allusion to the problem. With an air of infuriating smugness, he said, "Well, we shall soon see." You would never believe, thought Ian to himself, that so far the old boy had got it wrong every single time. As a matter of fact, the doctor was feeling pretty confident. The fact that on his last landing he had once again managed to reach the right planet was a considerable help. It left only the time coordinates to be sorted out. This time the doctor was pretty sure he'd pulled it off. All the instrument readings bore him out. They were on Earth, in England, and the year was 1963. Susan and he would soon be free of their irritating companions and able to resume their travels. What could possibly go wrong? The doctor was about to find out. It started innocently enough. Barbara rested her hand idly on the console, then snatched it away. Ouch! The doctor looked up from the controls. What's the matter? It's hot. I nearly burned myself. Hot? Where? The doctor touched the part of the console that Barbara indicated and gave a sharp intake of breath. Yes, some overheating going on there, I'm afraid. It's just as well we're landing. Susan, check the fault indicator, please. As Susan ran to an instrument panel built into the TARDIS wall, Barbara regarded the central console with alarm. It won't blow up, will it? No, of course not, said the doctor huffily. But he looked worried all the same. It's just that, well, there we were in France in the middle of the 18th century. His voice tailed off, and he looked vague for a moment, as if all the complexity of it all was getting beyond even him. Barbara gave him a worried look, and the doctor rallied. I've tried a new navigational sequence to sidestep the ship to England in the middle of the 20th century. You mean you've taken a wild stab at it in the vague hope that this time it will work out all right, thought Barbara to herself. But she didn't say it out loud. The doctor would only have denied it indignantly and told her she was too ignorant to understand. Susan was studying the instrument panel. There's a reading on QR18, Grandfather, and another on A14D. Both are on yellow standby. The doctor studied the control console. The rise of the center column was slowing perceptibly now. Another minute and we'll be landing. Those fault indicator readings, began Ian. What? Oh, QR18 concerns the atmospheric pressure outside the ship, and AD14 is the ship's weight. And the yellow standby? A yellow standby warns us to examine the two at the earliest opportunity. The doctor stared abstractedly into space. Pressure and weight. Suddenly an alarm signal blared out. Grandfather, the doors! Shouted Susan. She pointed. Something's wrong with the doors! They all turned and saw that the TARDIS doors were beginning to open. The doctor sprang to the console and threw a switch. Nothing happened. Close them, Chesterton, he shouted. We haven't fully materialized yet. Close them! Ian ran to the door and hurled himself against them. They seemed quite immovable, and he felt all the helplessness of man against machine. Barbara and Susan came to help him. All three heaved frantically, and suddenly the doors gave way to their joint efforts and closed. Gasping, Ian turned round and saw that the doctor was leaning on the console, one hand supporting him, the other clasped to his forehead. Ian went over to him. Are you all right, Doctor? The doctor didn't reply, and Ian touched him gently on the shoulder. The doctor started. Hey, what is it? Are you all right? I thought you seemed...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.